It's my choice. I need my Savior and my God. What a great day to be in the house of the Lord. Sunday, Amen. The Lord's Day. Amen. You're so glad you're here. Good crowd this morning. Let's take our hymnals out and turn over to, here it is, number, I got it here, marked with a paper book. Blessed be the name. Number seven in our hymn book. Blessed be the name. Let's all stand and sing this together as we start our Sunday school hour. Christian flag and then our U.S. flag.
I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will make it a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will hide its words in my heart that I might not sin against God.
Good. Love that pledge. On the Christian flag.
I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior for whose kingdom it stands. One Savior crucified, risen and coming again, with life and liberty for all who believe.
Good. Then our U.S. flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right. Good job of all those. You may be seated. So I have a couple volunteers to take up the offering this morning. Anybody want to volunteer? Young person, teenager, adult, doesn't matter to me. Anybody want to help Tayshawn? Come on up. Somebody want to help Tayshawn with the offering this morning? You know, if no one helps it, I got to appoint my son Levi. He's like, I might as well raise my hand. I'm going to be asked anyway. Thank you, son. Thank you, Tayshawn. Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for this day you've given to us. It's your day, and I pray that we'll remember everything we do, or whether we're taking up offerings or giving offerings or preaching or listening in class, it's all can be done for you. Lord, I pray that these offerings will be given to you, realizing that we're doing it for you because we love you so much. In Jesus' name, amen.
Mm-hmm. another. Good morning, everyone. So good to see your smiling faces this morning. Just want to mention a couple of things. One thing you won't find in your bulletin, but it's on the table back there, is a sample ballot. Okay? These won't be accepted Tuesday night. We do not, our Constitution has been this way all, ever since I can remember. No absentee voting as far as church matters on a business meeting. But you can see who is on the ballot. You can pray about it. And some of them, you say, well, some of them are just shoe-ins. There's nobody opposing them. That's true. But there are a couple where it says vote for one. In other words, you need to vote for one or the other. Pray over that. So that's back there. Also, to remind you about Faith Promise Missions and the Faith Promise card back there, you can pray about that. And I just want to remind you that we have a deacons meeting tonight at 5 p.m. And our evening service, of course, is at 6. And then this coming Tuesday night is our annual business meeting. And so be praying about these matters. So those are things that are coming up that are heavily weighing on us. And I will say this, thank you for praying for Mary. She's making her recovery is steady. It's slow. She has been in a lot of pain, but she's been trying to avoid the hard stuff, you know, the oxy, because of all the bad side effects of it, even though it might give you relief from pain, but it causes other kinds of pain. So I'm proud of her in this regard. She's tough in being able to handle pain a lot better than I can, let me tell you that right now. But be praying for her, because she is making progress. I'm so thankful.
Pastor Mark.
All right, thank you, Pastor.
Appreciate that. Any birthdays this last week? We cut cake this week. Can we cut cake for birthday? How about a wedding anniversary? Any of those? This week. Last week. All right. None of those as well. All right. We're going to sing Give Me Oil in My Lamp. It's in our hymnal number 254. If you want to look at it, two verses there. 254. I think most of the kids know it. Let's all stand and sing this chorus, and then we will be dismissed to our Sunday school classes. Give Me Oil in My Lamp. Sing that while the other ones do the second one. The other part on the verse, the chorus, I guess. Let's sing verse number 2. Make me a fisher of men.
Make me a fisher of men. Keep me sinking. Make me a fisher of men. I pray.
Hallelujah.
Make me a fisher of men. Keep me sinking. Sinking souls till Jesus comes again. Sing, Hosanna.
I'm encouraged by a pretty good crowd in our Sunday school this morning. Thankful for that. We will be in chapter 2 of Revelation, and we'll be picking up in verse 12 in a few moments. Besides the prayer request about Mary, as I mentioned already, and I'll jot that down, we had a week ago, Friday, Mike and I had a very good meeting with Tom Miedema, and we nailed some things down. But I had a little fear. I don't know if I mentioned it. I can't remember what I said, what I was thinking, and what I said. I had a little fear about some of these decisions without running it by some people, you know? And not that I didn't trust him, he's got good ideas, but I just thought somebody could come along later and say, who decided this? You know? And so we called a building committee meeting, and that happened Thursday night at 7. And we came up with a couple of good changes concerning the new building. We're actually going to have two bathrooms in there, not just one. And they'll be identical. They won't necessarily be male, female, but it'll be two bathrooms. We're going to have a door there that we had eliminated. And I think this will make it better for if we ever want to pull down the door that's going to be a drop-down door between the existing and the new, and use it, maybe somebody wants to use it for something, they can have that without having to come into this part of the church or use this part. So that was wise, and I'm thankful. We also discussed the flooring and what we're going to be using out there, and all that was good. We had a good meeting. It was a very profitable one. So be praying about the building project. It's getting closer, and I'm excited. I'm very excited about that. I have a special prayer request this morning. Is Stephen, my son-in-law, is going to India next month on a mission trip. And so we're just praying for him and Pastor Moss and about seven or eight other men from their church down there, Cross Point. And so just pray for Tanya and the boys and all that she's going through dealing with Daniel in his absence. So pray about that, the whole ball of wax, please. Keep praying for Daniel's salvation. Olivia, doing pretty good right now. Recently, she did have a minor seizure. I can't remember the date. I think I told you guys about it. But just keep praying for her. Sue Helms, we keep mentioning in prayer and asking God to help her because of her pain. Clinton and Vera Sanders, going through a lot right now. Well, we keep praying for them and want to. Business meeting Tuesday night, mentioned it, but we need to pray for it, okay? And Pastor Mark's dad's doing pretty good right now. Pray for our teens. Pastor Mark shared some, just some burdens and some unspokens, and we could say the same about our van ministry and about our youth truth night and all of these things, that God would help them to grow and kind of in a rebuilding phase. I think that's exciting in its own right. Do you have any other prayer? How about unspokens? I know, yes, there's quite a few of those. All right. Any other prayer requests this morning? Barb?
That's just a prayer. That's great. Mike's home, and Mike near your home. He's got to fly 25 hours with an hotel. 25 hours of flight time with an instructor before he can fly
solo as a pilot.
And he's flying as ALLIGIANT. Allegiant.
Oh, that's good. I like flying with them. Awesome. That's great to hear that. So we keep praying for Mike and Angie. Glad they're home safely, and we'll pray for him as he goes through more of this training. That's great. Yes, Lena.
I have a prayer request for my son, Ernie Weber, Nuevo. He's going to go in for surgery this week, a knee surgery.
Knee?
Yes.
All right, let's pray for Ernie Weber, everyone.
Yes.
Knee surgery. Is that a replacement or just a...
I don't know what they're going to do. I don't know.
Okay. Yes. We will be praying for him. Yes. Anyone else? I did hear from a couple of times from Tom Cecil. He texted to say he had received an encouraging card from the church and that he was praying for all of us back here. And he's got some great blessings and testimonies to share when he gets back in March. The Lord's helped him to have some inroads with people in his witnessing and passing out tracts, and that's exciting. We miss him, but... just keep praying for Tom Cecil, if you will. And get my hands to write. Any other prayer requests? All right, let's go to Lord in prayer. Lord, Thank you. Thank you for your many blessings. Most of all for salvation, Lord. And I pray that you'll bless me, the message of the next service at 10:30. I pray, Father, for the power of the Holy Spirit upon the word, preaching of the word this morning. And Lord, I do pray for Mary as she recovers. Thank you that I'm seeing progress, albeit she's still in a lot of discomfort, a lot of pain. Please help her. Thank you for the generosity and the love of so many who brought meals over this week. And thank you for that, the concern and the support and encouragement. I do continue to ask you to continue to pray and to help us with the building project, Lord. And be with Stephen and all of the men going to India next month. Please bring them home safely, Lord. Help them to have an effective ministry when they go there. I pray for Daniel and his salvation. And Lord, I pray for Tanya. She deals with a lot with him. I pray for Olivia. And Lord, that you would just help her minimize these seizures or eliminate them, please. And Lord, we don't want to forget to pray for Ava Lynn as she's got to go in this week to have that cast taken off and her arm x-rayed and looked at. And I pray that all is going well with her recovery and healing. Help Sue Helms, Lord, with her pain, and please touch her and heal her. I pray for Clinton and Vera Sanders and what they're going through. Please help them, Lord. Give them hope. Give them encouragement. I pray for the business meeting Tuesday night. May all go well. May we do things decently and in order. I pray, Father, for Pastor Mark's dad. Thank you that he's doing well. Lord, I do pray for these unspokens that have to do with each individual that raised their hand. Also concerning our teens and our van ministry and other things in relation to our children's ministry. Bless it mightily, Lord. I do pray for Mike and Angie. Maybe thank you that they're back in the area. Bless him on his flight time as he builds up towards flying for Allegiant. And protect him, Lord. Help him. I pray, Father, for Lena's son, Ernie Weber, as he has knee surgery this week. May it go well. And I pray for Tom Cecil while he's away from us. Lord, he has a heart for spreading the word. Protect him down there and bring him back home safely. Now, Lord, bless our study in your precious word. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Today, we're going to talk about Pergamos. But before we do, I want to tell you something I'm planning. By the time we finish the seven churches, I hope to have a printout to you. And the reason I haven't yet, I'm starting to have some problems with it. With my computer of communicating with printers. So I had to do some finagling today to make this print. And so that kept me from getting this printed that I wanted to share with you. Remember how we have said that the seven churches represent not just only actual literal churches, remember we've mentioned that, but they go beyond that. They are in their order for a reason. Because the seven churches represent seven, you might call it epochs or eras of time within the vast era, the age called the church age. And so Ephesus would represent the times, for this is literal time that this happened that compares to this church. Ephesus, AD 31, they're guessing on that, about the time the church began, 32, we don't know exactly. So we'll just put 80, 30s to about 100. That's the first church, Ephesus. Smyrna represents them from AD 100 to about 313. And some might ask, well, what's the significance of 313? Well, Pergamos represents 313 to 358. And that in particular is kind of the word Pergamos has the idea of marriage. It is the marriage of Christianity with paganism, okay? And that was where Constantine saw a vision of the cross and embraced Christianity and supposedly got saved and made it the official state religion and all of that. Now, you might say, well, that was a good thing. Just remember, that was of the devil, okay? this marriage of the church with paganism. It muddies the water. It's not the delineation of the scripture. It is a fake Christ in the sense of these people that are trusting in. And so it was a warning to that church to beware because of some of the things they compare it to. We'll read about in a few moments. So that time period was very, very much about with this marriage. And then Thyatira, from about 538 to the 1500s, this is comparable to the Dark Ages in this regard. The Dark Ages, some say, oh, the Dark Ages. Well, that was because everybody used coal to burn in their houses, and there was so much smoke and clouds hanging over every city that they couldn't see the sun. It was the Dark Ages. No, it was a great dark age before the Bible was in the hands of every man. The church, quote, the Catholic Church had a monopoly on the Word of God. Okay, what I mean by that is they said, we will tell you what the Word of God says. They didn't tell the truth about the Word of God. They started selling indulgences, and they were breaking in buku amounts of money and gold by the selling of these indulgences. Great inquisitions, all of these persecutions of believers who said, no, this is not what's been handed down to us from the true fathers. And you had persecution of the Anabaptists and the Waldensians and the Huguenots, and I could go on and on and on. So it was the Dark Ages, but it was dark heart, spiritual darkness, okay? And Thyatira, we'll get to that when we get to it. Sardis represents the 1500s to the 1700s. That would be the Reformation, pretty much. And you know, the most important invention of all time, what was it? No, it's not toilet paper. It was the printing press, okay? And so those things happened to work together towards the common man having the Word of God. And then Philadelphia is one of those churches, there's only two of them, Smyrna and Philadelphia, who had, the Lord gave them no negative comments. It was just an encouragement. Philadelphia, 1700s to the 1840s, represents the great missionary endeavors that launched all over the world. They didn't stop. Praise the Lord. Missionary work is going on still today, but there was a great fervor for that in that time, and Philadelphia represents that time age, that time of the church age, from the 1700s to about 1840s. And then finally, Laodicea, the 1840s all the way to the second coming of Christ. And it represents, of course, how that liberalism crept in. And you'll notice some of these churches, the Lord warns them that they're going to go through the tribulation period. That's interesting. The spirit and the nature of their error would continue right through the tribulation period. That means some of these people that claim to be saved are not, and they will not be caught up in the rapture. So it's the mindset, whether it be the mindset of Pergamos or the mindset of Thyatira, that's going to go all the way to the end of the tribulation period. And we'll see some very interesting ways that Christ words things here. So, all right. I prayed already. Let's start reading in verse number 12. And to the angel of the church in Pergamos write, these things saith he which hath the sharp sword with two edges. Now, we know John said in the beginning was the Word, Logos, and the Word was with God. We know from Hebrews it says that the Word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. We know from the visual picture of looking at Christ's revelation of Revelation 19, when we get to it, that when he comes back on a white horse, he will come in power and great glory, but he will fight against his enemies, and there's a sharp sword that goeth out of his mouth. Not a literal piece of metal sticking out of his mouth, but rather his word is sharper than any two-edged sword. And he hath the sharp sword with two edges. His word will cut like a knife. His word will destroy his enemies and cut them to pieces. And you can mark that down, that's going to happen. So we see this allusion here of the sharp sword with two edges is his word and his power of speaking his word. I know thy works and where thou dwellest, even where Satan's seat is. That's an interesting thought right there, Satan's seat. Now, I'm sure that Satan he's pulled up and moved his capital around a few times, I wouldn't doubt. Pergamos as a place today is just ruins. I don't think Satan's seat is still there. But that was an effective place for him to work out of. And Jesus said, "That's you're yes, I know your works. You're right there where Satan's seat is." It kind of reminds me of somebody starting a church, and there are good Baptist churches in Las Vegas, Nevada. Sin City, if you will. A place that was created for debauchery and gambling and sexual perversion and all the things that go there. Never been there, but I don't desire to go there, but I know a lot about it from just all you have to do is watch TV and hear all kind of things about it. Las Vegas, Sin City. By the way, that's not the only Sin City in the United States, is it? But you would be thinking about, wow, how tough would it be to have a church in Sin City? Boy, you would really be facing, it's pretty much that way all over America now. And so we've got to face that reality. But he says, where thou dwellest, even where Satan's seat is, and thou holdest fast my name. What a good testimony, even amidst all of these negative things he's going to say to them, they were holding fast his name. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of Jesus Christ, that you may know that you have eternal life. The name of Christ is so important. The name of Jesus. We are trusting in his name. We know that his name means salvation. We know that we put faith in what he's done for us. So there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. We can't be saved by Muhammad. We can't be saved by Buddha. We can't be saved by anybody else but Jesus. Amen? And so even in the midst of our own Pergamos here in the world, and we have to be careful because we have kind of been guilty too of marrying these ideas. Why don't we, and I know this is a push with a lot of churches, why don't we bring in some of these fancy, attention-grabbing methods of the world, and that's why some churches have become mega churches, because they put on concerts and all kinds of loud music, but they think, hey, the end justifies the means, and let's go down this path. No, we are about holding fast the name of Jesus Christ. And let's don't be apologetic for that. Okay? We're thankful. And hast not denied my faith. Yep, there are people in this world today, because we're watching it before our very eyes, the falling away spoken of in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. That day shall not come except there become a falling away first, that the man of sin be revealed. This falling away, this great apostasy, is denominations and churches that at one time had leaders who believed the Bible, who held fast to his name, who held fast to the faith, and they preached the word. They are no longer doing that. That has fallen by the way. They have something else to hold up. It's not the Bible. And so even in a time period, even in a church where Satan's seat was, not in the church, but in that town, even in a place, they had at least enough common sense, spiritual sense, however you want to word it, to hold fast to the faith. We'll talk more about that later. And hast not denied my faith. There's a lot of pressure on Christians today to just shut up. A lot of pressure from the world. We don't want to hear what you have to say. Be quiet. Well, didn't they say that to Peter and John? And he said, we have to obey God rather than men. They beat them. They scourged them. They don't say anything else in this name. And they went forward rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer for Christ. But did they shut up? No. They kept going. We must not shut up. We must not let the pressure of the world tell us, tone it down, calm down. That's hate speech. You know, they can say that in Lansing. They can put it on the books that something we say from the Bible, whether it be about homosexuality or any other kind of perversion or conversion therapy, as they like to call it. We call it soul winning, okay? They can say, you can't do that. We have to just trust God and not deny the faith. Even in those days wherein Antipas was my faithful martyr who was slain among you. This also reminds us that there is a possibility when we stand for God that the outcome as far as our physical life could be death. All through these 20 centuries, think about it, 2 millennia, 20 centuries, 200 decades, you could say, or longer, there have been many people that have died for their faith. There have been many people that have been burned at the stake, that have been hung, that have been driven into abject poverty and then forced into situations where they literally starved to death or died. Not necessarily a direct execution, but it was an indirect. Read the Fox's Book of Martyrs. Read the book Tortured for His Faith by Harlan Popoff. Read, what's the great book? I remember Berto was sharing it with me. The Trail of Blood. For people, the people that have died for making a stand about baptism. That's all because of these false teachings and Satan promoting them. So he says, where Satan dwelleth. A reminder. So this man, Antipas, he's already received the crown of life. He's already stood before his Lord and been rewarded because he was a faithful martyr. Wow. All right. But it's a good word in some cases, but in some other cases, the contrast is negative. But it's kind of like back there with Ephesus. He said, nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee. Here, he says, but I have a few things against thee. Because thou hast there them that hold the doctrine of Balaam. Now, there, in their church, they had allowed some doctrine that was sketchy, that was iffy. Yes, they had been standing true in their faith and holding to the name of Christ. But this doctrine had crept in. And this is actually the beginning, you could say, if you want to look at the church age as a general, this is the beginning of the Catholic Church in these years from 313 on. Now, you might say, when was it actually begun? Exact date? I don't know. But I know that it really started rising after you'll see this doctrine here that helped it to get if you remember, after Constantine, there was a split in the official church. This is not the church that we claim to, another, not the received text and that. I'm talking about with Constantinople was where he had his seat, and it ended up being a split between Constantinople and what major city of Europe? Rome, yes. And so today, even today, you have the Catholic Church and you have Eastern Orthodox. You heard of that? They're very big in some parts of Russia, some parts of Greece, Asia Minor, which is mainly Muslim now. But in some of these other countries, the Greek Orthodox. And that was a split with the Catholic Church. And so without going into all the detail about that, They split over a few things, but they mirror them too much in other things. So I'm not saying, oh, good, choose this one over that one. I'm saying both of these are corrupt in their own way, all right? But they had there a doctrine, the doctrine of Balaam. Balaam wasn't able to curse Israel, but he sure tried. He wanted to. And it's interesting. It's a little confusing. You go back there to Numbers and read about him. It is very confusing that God had somebody, a man, who claimed to be a servant of the Lord, but yet he was so driven by greed. He wanted that payoff. And Balak just got so flustered with him because every time that he went to a high place, and it was like three or four times, he ended up blessing Israel. Boy, it really made Balak. But then he left behind a very dangerous legacy. Later, the Bible tells us that Moses, this is before Moses' own death and before the children of Israel crossed over, Moses killed him with a sword in one of their battles because he was of, Balaam was of the region east of the Dead Sea and that region and those people. But this man, he taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel. This is the little glimpse that we may not hear exactly said back there, but as you read on, you'll see it. He taught Balak, he says, hey, to use modern terms, if you can't beat them, join them. That's a good way to think about it. And so they started trying to intermingle. They started intermarrying. They were committing fornication with the children of Israel. And that drew them away to go after their gods and commit idolatry. And so that's why it goes on to say, to eat things sacrificed unto, to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat things sacrificed unto idols, and to commit fornication. So the danger, the real danger of tolerating someone like a Balaam. Now this wasn't a literal Balaam, was it? Because he's been long dead. But it was someone that compares to him in his dangerous infection of the church there. That they said, I have nevertheless some against you. You have there. You haven't rooted this out. You haven't recognized it. You haven't pinpointed it and say, hey, this is wrong. We gotta stop. No, you can't. You know, that's the problem. And a lot of churches have gone downhill quickly towards the realm of apostasy as far as their leaders. There can still be believers in the group, just like when we think about these groups of Catholicism, there are saved people in Catholicism. Why? Because they have gotten a hold of the Word of God, and it had the same effect on them that it did with Martin Luther when he nailed his 95 theses to the Wittenbach church door. It's the Word of God is powerful. Amen. It's quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. But in that statement, in every denomination, there might be someone that's truly saved. Now, when you start talking about the cults, and if they believe in some of the things the cults believe, which are denying the deity of Christ, I won't say that there are groups within those cults that are saved until they deny those things. But anyway, I think you know what I mean. Here was, in a church, someone that was preaching a doctrine of tolerance, acceptance of lifestyles that were definitely prohibited by Christ. Fornication, idolatry. So hast thou also them that hold the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which thing I hate. Did you notice just two churches before? It was the deeds of the Nicolaitans. If you remember what we talked about, Nico conquer laity people. The actions of these early groups was to set up a hierarchy, to set up a system where you suppress the common person in the pew and you elevate yourself. You have to have a hierarchy. This led to the Pope, cardinals, bishops, and so forth. And that's not just in the Catholic Church. There's hierarchies in other groups as well. Remember, Christ is the great equalizer. At the cross is level ground. No Christian is greater than any other Christian. Jesus said it in the least in the kingdom of God is greater than he who was referring to John the Baptist. He said John the Baptist is the man, greatest man born of woman. And then as he kept talking, he said, but the least in the kingdom of God is greater than he. God, Christ is the great equalizer. And he hates, notice how he phrases this, which thing I hate. He hates the deeds that turned into the doctrine of the Nicolaitans. It is a doctrine of uppity, self-centered, self-promotion, conquering of the people. And we have to be very careful that we don't fall into that mindset. I remember one preacher that I had. I don't know his heart. I can't say that I do. But sometimes you get an impression, you know? And I had him for a couple of years before the pastor I was saved under. And he had an air about him that you couldn't approach him. He had an air about him that he was better. It was an air. It's an impression. It could have been a wrong. I was only a little kid. I never could approach him. I remember one time wanting to ask him to sign my Bible. And it was kind of like, go on, I'm busy. You know, that kind of thing. But that was just an error. It's an impression. It could have been wrong. I don't know his heart. But if we think we are better, oh, that's a sad, sad attitude for any Christian to have, to think you're better than another. And believe me, that's what this leads to. And Jesus hates this doctrine of the Nicolaitans that has come in and infiltrated some churches. And I pray that we never entertain it. Then notice the word repent. Verse 16. Repent, or else I will come unto thee quickly and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth. Very interesting wording. He says, he doesn't say this. Repent, or else I will come unto thee quickly and fight against you. Our Lord doesn't fight against his beloved saved individuals that are part of the bride of Christ. But he does fight against them that are fakes, that are the tares, that are the counterfeits. And he ultimately will fight against them at the battle of Armageddon. But I think that there is the case for repentance again. Repentance is not just entry level. It is needed when we get saved. We need to truly repent. But we can keep repenting as sin comes along, as we're reminded through the Holy Spirit about something we're doing wrong. Repentance, turning away from sin. Repent, or else I will come unto thee quickly. Then finally, we have a few more minutes. We're going to spend the rest of the time here in this last verse. What a great thought. Some great thoughts here. He says, he that hath an ear. Everybody has ears, but not everybody's listening. He that hath an ear, he that hath an ear towards listening to what Jesus is saying, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. This is a reminder, too, that each of these messages to these churches is, you might say, well, we're in the Laodicean church. There's nothing from Ephesus to Philadelphia for us. Don't read it that way. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. Each church has something for you, Christian. Each church has something that could help you. Each church has something that could encourage you or warn you. So don't think of it in the sense of, well, like you said, Pastor, we're in the Laodicean age. No, we are. But each one of these churches, if you've left your first love, or if this is an issue about tolerating bad doctrine, or even tolerating this doctrine of the Nicolaitans, he says, repent. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh, a reminder, every one of these churches has a message about overcoming. To him that overcometh. Who are the overcomers? The believer. The believer is an overcomer because 1 John 5:4 says, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. Faith is the victory. Isn't that great? So he says, to him that overcometh, and what's the reward? Will I give to eat of the hidden manna? It's hidden for us right now. We can't see it. But just imagine the table fare of it in glory. They complained as they looked down and they said, and the whole word meant, what is it? There's been a couple of meals that Mary made and put in front of me that I could have said manna in front of it because I didn't know what it was. Now, what is it? I'll never forget her making a allspice pizza. That's a funny story I hear, let her tell you. She had worked at Myers, and she was talking to some girls there. And I was still working for Pioneer. We hadn't been married very long. We're getting ready to leave to go to Tennessee. And so it's in the probably November, December of 1979. And she talked to these girls and said, you know, you ought to get, look at the spice aisle and find some spices. Spice up your cooking and try different things. So she saw this, hey, allspice, that's got them all in one thing. I'll use allspice. So she made this pizza, put a lot of allspice on it. Let's go to McDonald's. But I'll never forget saying, what is this? You know, they said, what is it? And they got to eat, as the Bible referred to it as angel food, talking about the children of Israel. They got to eat a miracle food every day. And they got sick of it because their hearts were not right. They were eating the best of the best. I mean, it was sweet like honey. It had some other descriptions that we don't know what that means, but wow, they went out and picked it up every morning. It was amazing, a miracle. God nourished them and sustained them with it. He is going to let us eat of the hidden manna. Wow, that's going to be interesting. It's going to be delicious. It's going to be a joy. It's going to be heavenly. Think about that. We get to eat of this hidden manna. And I find that something exciting. I'm almost done. And we'll give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name written, which no man knoweth saving he that receiveth it. And you don't like your name? I'm not going to comment on your name. My name is Dennis Leroy Tyson. I've had a lot of jokes. People have made fun of my middle name. In fact, I worked with groups. I worked at a grocery store. They never called me by my first name. Hey, Leroy, where you been? You know, it was constant. I don't blame my mom for that because I loved my grandfather that I was named after. It don't matter. People want to make fun of your name. Have you got a name people make fun of? You're going to have a white stone. You're going to turn that thing over? I don't know. It might not be on the bottom of it. I might be thinking that wrong. And I'll give him a new stone, and in the stone a new name written. Maybe it will shine out of that stone like light coming out of a diamond. And in that, your name, a new name written. Mm-hmm. Wow. That's exciting. It's just a glimpse. It's just a tantalizing little taste of what it's going to be like in heaven when we get to enjoy these things. Because you are an overcomer, because you are living by faith, because you trust the Lord, even though you got problems down here, even though you fail in a lot of ways, you are an overcomer because Jesus, he says, in this world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. So we are overcomers because he is an overcomer. Well, I need to stop. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the promises, the joy of these studies about the seven churches. Help us to beware of toleration of evil, false doctrine, wrong thinking. Help us, Lord, to hold fast your name and to hold fast to the faith. In Jesus' name.